Hello and welcome to your favorite podcast channel Knowledge, and in today's episode I am going to present a very beautiful summary on a book written by Dale Carnegie, how to win friends and influence people. So friends, let's begin. I hope you'll enjoy this book summary, how to win friends and influence people. So let's begin, and if you like this podcast, please do give a thumbs up, like, subscribe and share this podcast. So let's begin, and you can subscribe my YouTube channel for further beautiful summaries, and this podcast will also help you learn English in a better way. So let's begin. First chapter describes how you can handle different kinds of people. If you want to gather honey, don't kick over the beehive. On May 7, 1931, the most sensational manhunt the New York City has ever known had come to its climax. Sensational means great or exciting. Manhunt means search for a criminal. Climax means most exciting part of the story. And after weeks of search, two gun Crowley, the killer, the gunman who didn't smoke or drink, was at bay, trapped in his sweetheart's apartment on Western Avenue. Sweetheart's matlab, the person you love very much. 150 policemen and detectives laid siege to his top floor hideaway. Laid siege means when soldiers surround a target is called a lay siege. Hideaway means a place where somebody is hidden. That is called hideaway. They chopped holes in the roof. Chopped holes in the roof means they cut the roof and entered. They tried to smoke out Crowley, the cop killer, with tear gas. Then they mounted their machine guns on surrounding buildings. And for more than an hour, New York's fine residential areas reverberated with crack of pistol fire. Reverberated means to become filled with a sound. Sound, something reverberating in your ear, is coming again and again. With the crack of pistol fire and the rat, rat, tat of machine guns. Crowley crouching behind an overstuffed chair. Crouching means to lie with legs bent. Ghutno ke bal je baitha usko bolte hain. Crouching behind an overstuffed, completely full out, two full chair, fired incessantly without being stopped at police. 10,000 excited people watched the battle. Nothing like it had ever happened before on the sidewalks of New York. Sidewalks mean path along the edge of the road. When Crowley was captured, Police Commissioner E.P. Murloni declared that two gunmen desperado. Two gun desperado was one of the most dangerous criminals ever encountered in the history of New York. "We will kill," said Commissioner, "at the drop of the feather." Desperado means violent criminal. Desperado, violent criminal. At the drop of the head, at the drop of the feather means immediately. But how did two gunmen Crowley regard himself? You know, because while the police were firing into his apartment, he wrote a letter addressed to whom it may concern. And as he wrote, the blood flying from his wound left a crimson trail on the paper. Crimson means red colored. In his letter, Crowley said, "Under my coat is a weary hurt, but a kind one, one that would do nobody any harm." A short time before this, Crowley had been having a necking party with his girlfriend. on the country road out on Long Island. Suddenly police walked up to his car and said, "Let me see your license." Without saying a word, Crowley drew his gun and cut the policeman down with a shower of lead. As dying officer fell, Crowley leaped out of the car and grabbed the officer's revolver and fired another bullet into prostrate body. Prostrate means to face down. And there was the killer who said, "And my coat is a weary hurt, but a kind one, one that would do nobody any harm." Crowley was sentenced to electric chair. When he arrived at death house in Sing Sing, did he say, "This is what I get for killing people"? No, he said, this is what I get for defending myself." The point of story is this. Two Gun Crowley didn't blame himself for anything. Is that an unusual attitude among criminals? If you think so, listen to this. "I have spent the best years of my life giving people the lighter places, helping them have a good time, and all I get is abuse, the existence of hunted man. That's all. That's Cap AI Capon speaking. He's America's most notorious public enemy, the most sinister gang leader who ever shot up Chicago. Capon didn't condemn himself. He actually regarded himself as a public benefactor. Benefactor means one who helps by giving money. An unappreciated and misunderstood public benefactor. And so did Dutch schools before he crumpled up under gangster bullet in New York. Crumpled up means suddenly bend and fall. Crumpled up. Bullet in New York. Dutch schools, one of New York's most notorious rats, said in a newspaper interview that he was a public benefactor and he believed it. "I have had some interesting correspondence with Lewis Laws, who was a warden of New York's infamous Sing Sing prison for many years, on the subject, and he declared that few of criminals in Sing Sing regard themselves as bad men. They're just as human as you. As you and I. And so they rationalize the exam, they explain. They can tell you why they had to crack a safe or be quick on the trigger finger. Most of them attempt by a form of reasoning, fallacious or logical, to justify their antisocial acts even to them. Fallacious means containing a mistake. Antisocial, violent or bad. Consequently, stoutly maintaining that they should never have been imprisoned at all. Stoutly means thick and strong. If I captain two Gun Crowley, Dutch schools and a desperate man and woman behind prison walls, don't blame themselves for anything. What about the people with whom you and I come in contact?" John Van Meeker, founder of stores that bear his name, once confessed, "I learned 30 years ago that it is foolish to scold. I have enough trouble overcoming my own limitations without fretting over the fact that God has not seen fit to distribute evenly the gift of intelligence." Fretting means worry or become concerned. Wanamaker learned this lesson early, but I personally had to blunder through this old world for a third of century before it began to down upon me that 39 times out of 100 people don't criticize themselves for anything, no matter how wrong it may be. Criticism is futile because it puts a person on the defensive and usually makes him strive to justify himself. Criticism is dangerous because it wounds a person's precious pride, hurts his sense of importance, and arouses resentment. B.F. Skinner, the world famous psychologist, proved through his experiments that a criminal rewarded for good behavior will learn much more rapidly and retain what it learns far more effectively than a criminal punished for bad behavior. Later studies have shown that same applies to humans. By criticizing, we don't make lasting changes and often incur resentment. So in this podcast, friends, you are listening a beautiful summary written by How to Win Friends and Influence People, written by Dale Carnegie, and the author is summarizing his experiences that he has shared in this book. Hans Selye, another great psychologist, said, as much as we thirst for approval, we dread condemnation. Dread means a feeling of fear. Condemnation expresses of strong criticism. The resentment that criticism engenders means to be cause of. Resentment, a feeling of anger, can demoralize employees, family members and friends, and still is not correct the situation that had been condemned. So there are different approaches we can go with in our lives. You'll find examples of futility of criticism bristling on 100 pages of his story. Take for example the famous quarrel between Roosevelt and President Taft, a quarrel that split the Republican Party, put Woodrow Wilson in the White House and wrote bold, luminous lines across First World War and altered the flow of history. Let's review facts quickly. When Theodore Roosevelt stepped out of the White House in 1908, he supported Taft. He was elected president. Then Theodore Roosevelt went off to Africa to shoot lions. When he returned, he exploded. He denounced Taft for his conservatism. Tried to secure the nomination for a third term himself, formed the Bull Moose Party, and all but demolished the GOP in the election that followed. William Howard Taft and Republican Party carried only two states, Vermont and Oot, the most disastrous defeat the party had ever won. So Theodore Roosevelt blamed theft, but did the president blame theft himself? Of course not. With the tears in his eyes, Taft said, "I don't see how I could have done any differently from what I have." So in this podcast, friends, this is very first episode. If you like this podcast, you can give a like, thumbs up, subscribe. This is beautiful podcast that will help you become fluent in English. And very beautiful words in between the podcast have been described beautifully and clearly in a elucidate and very clear manner. And if you like this podcast, please give thumbs up, like, subscribe and share. And please don't forget to press the bell icon below and subscribe my YouTube channel for many other beautiful stories and summaries on different books. So bye-bye. Have a nice day. Keep smiling. Keep studying. Smile. Bye-bye. And press the bell icon and comment on this podcast. Bye-bye.